The Gilgamesh epic ranks with the Babylonian myth of creation as one of the greatest literary productions of ancient Babylonia. The main element in its composition is a conglomeration of mythic matter, drawn from various sources, with perhaps a substratum of historic fact, the whole being woven into a continuous narrative around the central figure of Gilgamesh, Prince of Erech. It is not possible at present to fix the date when the epic was first written. Our knowledge of it is gleaned chiefly from mutilated fragments belonging to the Library of Assurbanipal, but from internal and other evidence we gather that some at least of the traditions embodied in the epic are of much greater antiquity than his reign. Thus, a tablet dated 2100 BC contains a variant of the deluge story inserted in the 11th tablet of the Gilgamesh epic. Probably this and other portions of the epic existed in oral tradition before they were committed to writing, that is, in the remote Sumerian period. Assurbanipal was an enthusiastic, practical patron of literature. In his great library at Nineveh, the nucleus of which had been taken from Kala by Sennacherib, he had gathered a vast collection of volumes, clay tablets, and papyri, most of which had been carried as spoil from conquered lands. He also employed scribes to copy older texts, and this is evidently how the existing edition of the Gilgamesh epic came to be written. From the fragments now in the British Museum, it would seem that at least four copies of the poem were made in the time of Assurbanipal. They were not long permitted to remain undisturbed. The great Assyrian Empire was already declining. Long Nineveh was captured and its library scattered, while plundering hordes burnt the precious rolls of papyrus and buried the clay tablets in the debris of the palace which had sheltered them. They were destined to lie for over 2,000 years, till the excavations of Sir A.H. Layard George Smith and others brought them to light. It is true that the 12 tablets of the Gilgamesh epic, or rather the fragments of them, which have so far been discovered, are much defaced. Frequently, the entire sense of a passage is obscured by a gap in the text, and this, when nice mythological elucidation are in question, is no light matter. Yet to such an extent has the science of comparative religion progressed in recent years that we are probably better able to read the true mythological significance of the epic than were the ancient Babylonians themselves, who saw it merely as an account of wanderings and exploits of a national hero. The epic, which centers around the ancient city of Erech, relates the adventures of a half-human, half-divine hero, Gilgamesh by name, who is king over Erech. Two other characters figure prominently in the narrative: Ebony, who evidently typifies primitive man, and Ut-Napishtim, the hero of the Babylonian deluge myth. Each of three would seem to have been originally the hero of a separate group of traditions, which in time became incorporated, much more or less naturally, with the other two. The first and most important of the trio, the hero Gilgamesh, may have been at one time a real personage, though nothing is known of him historically. Possibly the exploits of some ancient king of Erech had furnished a basis for the narrative. His name, for a time provisionally read Gijdubar or Izdubar, but now known to have been pronounced Gilgamesh, suggests that he was not Babylonian, but Elamite or Kassite in origin, and from indications furnished by the poem itself, we learn that he conquered Erech or relieved the city from a besieging force at the onset of his adventurous career. It has been suggested also that he was identical with the biblical Nimrod, like him, a hero of ancient Babylon. But there are no other grounds for the suggestion. So much for the historical aspect of Gilgamesh. His mythological character is more easily established. In this regard, he is the personification of the sun. He represents, in fact, the fusion of a great national hero with a mythical being. Throughout the epic, there are indications that Gilgamesh is partly divine by nature, though nothing specific is said on that head. His identity with the solar god is veiled in the popular narrative, but it is evident that he has some connection with the god Shamash, to whom he pays his devotion and who acts as his patron and protector. The birth of Gilgamesh. Among the traditions concerning his birth is one related by Ilion of Gilgamos, Gilgamesh, the grandson of Sakoros. Sakoros, who according to Berosus was the first king to reign in Babylon after the deluge, was warned by means of divination that his daughter should bear a son who would deprive him of his throne. Thinking to frustrate the designs of fate, he shut her up in a tower where she was closely watched. But in time she bore a son. Knowing how wroth the king would be to learn of the event, flung the child from the tower. But before he reached the ground, an eagle seized him up and bore him off to a certain garden, where he was duly found and cared for by a peasant. And when he grew to manhood, he became king of the Babylonians, having presumably usurped the throne of his grandfather. Here we have a myth obviously of solar significance, conforming in every particular to a definite type of sun legend. It cannot have been by chance that it became attached to the person of Gilgamesh. Everything in the epic, too, is consonant with the belief that Gilgamesh is a sun god. His connection with Shamash, who may have been his father in the tradition given by Ilion, as well as the eagle which saved him from death. The fact that no mention is made of his father in the poem, though his mother is brought in more than once, and the assumption throughout the epic that he is more than human. Given the key to his mythical character is not hard to perceive in his adventures the daily or annual course of the sun, rising to its full strength at noonday or midsummer, and sinking at length to the western horizon to return in due time to the abode of men. Like all solar deities, like the sun itself, his birth and origin are wrapped in mystery. He is indeed one of the fatal children, like Sargon, Perseus, or Arthur. When he first appears in the narrative, he is already a full-grown hero, the ruler, and it would seem, oppressor of Erech. His mother, Rimat Belit, is a priestess in the temple of Ishtar, and through her, he descended from Ut-Napishtim, a native of Shurippak, and the hero of the Babylonian flood legend. Early in the narrative, he is brought into contact with the wild man Ebani, originally designed for his destruction by the gods, but with whom he eventually concludes a firm friendship. The pair proceed to do battle with the monster Kumbaba, whom they overcome, as they do also the sacred bull sent against them by Anu. Up to the end of the fifth tablet, their conquering and triumphant career is without interruption. Gilgamesh increases in strength, as does the sun approaching the zenith. At the seventh tablet, however, his good fortune begins to wane. Ebani dies, slain doubtless by the wrath of Ishtar, whose love Gilgamesh has rejected with scorn, and the hero, mourning the death of his friend, and smitten with fear that he himself will perish in like manner, decides to go in search of his ancestor, Ut-Napishtim, who, as sole survivor of the deluge, has received from the gods deification and immortality, and learn of him the secret of eternal life. His further adventures have not the triumphal character of his earlier exploits. Sunwise, he journeys to the Mountain of the Sunset, encounters the Scorpion Men, and crosses the waters of death. Ut-Napishtim teaches him the lesson that all men must die, he himself being an exception in an exceptional circumstances, and though he afterwards gives Gilgamesh an opportunity of eating the plant of life, the opportunity is lost. However, Ut-Napishtim cures Gilgamesh of a disease which he has contracted, apparently while crossing the waters of death, and he is finally restored to Erech. In these happenings, we see the gradual sinking of the sun into the underworld by way of the Mountain of the Sunset. It is possible for the sun to attain immortality, to remain forever in the land of the living. He must traverse the waters of death and sojourn in the underworld. Yet the return of Gilgamesh to Erech signifies the fresh drawing of the day. It is the eternal struggle of day and night, summer and winter. Darkness may conquer light, but light will emerge again victorious. The conquest is unending. Some authorities have seen in the division of the epic into 12 tablets a connection with the months of the year or the signs of the zodiac. Such a connection probably exists, but when we consider that the artificial division of the epic into tablets scarcely tallies with the natural divisions of the poem, it seems likely that the astrological significance of the former was given to the epic by the scribes of Nineveh, who were evidently at some pains to compress the matter into 12 tablets. Of the astral-theological significance of the narrative itself, one of its most important aspects, we shall perhaps be better able to judge when we have considered it in detail. Ebony. The most important of the various mythological strata underlying the Gilgamesh myth is probably that concerning Ebony, as has been said, is a type of primitive man, living among the beasts of the field as one of themselves. But he is also, according to certain authorities, a form of the sun god, even as Gilgamesh himself. Like the hero of Erech, he rises to the zenith of his powers, in a triumphal progress, then descends into the underworld. He is not lost sight of, however, but lives in the memory of his friend Gilgamesh. And in the 11th tablet, he is temporarily brought forth from the underworld, that is, his ghost, or Utuku, which is a dim and shadowy fashion may typify the daily restorations of the sun. Another important stratum of myth is that which concerns Upnapishtim, the Babylonian Noah. But whereas the myths of Ebony and Gilgamesh, though still distinguishable, have become thoroughly fused, the deluge story of Utnapishtim is the hero has been inserted bodily into the 11th tablet of the epic, being related to Gilgamesh by Utnapishtim himself. When he first appears in the narrative, he has the attributes and powers of a god, having received these for his fidelity to the gods during the flood. From those waters, he alone of all mankind escaped. The objective of his narrative in the Gilgamesh epic seems to be to point out to the hero that only the most exceptional circumstances, unique circumstances, indeed can save man from his doom. Other distinct portions of the epic are the battle with the monster Kumbaba, the episodes of Ishtar's love for Gilgamesh, the fight with the sacred bull of Anu, and the search for the plant of life. These, whatever their origin, have become naturally incorporated with the story of Gilgamesh. But besides the various historical and mythical elements herein presented, there is also a certain amount of Babylonian religious doctrine, evident to some extent in the 11th tablet, which points the moral that all men must die, but doubly in the 12th tablet, wherein the shade of Ebony appears to Gilgamesh, relates the misfortune of the unburied dead, or of those uncared for after death, and inculcates care for the deceased as the only means whereby they may evade the grievous woes which threaten them in the underworld. Let us examine in detail the Gilgamesh epic, as we have seen in the broken fragments which remain to us. The first and second tablet are much mutilated. A number of fragments are extant which belong to one another of these two, but it is not easy to say where the first ends and the second begins. One fragment would seem to contain the very beginning of the first tablet, or a sort of general preface to the epic, a compromising list of the advantages to be derived from reading it. After this comes a fragment whose title to inclusion in the epic is doubtful. It describes a siege of the city of Erech, but makes no mention of Gilgamesh. The woeful condition of Erech under the siege is thus picturesquely detailed. She assesses, tread down, their young, cow, turn upon their calves, men cry aloud like beasts, and maidens mourn like doves. The gods of strong-walled Erech are changed to flies, and buzz about the streets. The spirits of strong-walled Erech are changed to serpents, and glide into holes. For 3 years the enemy besieged Erech, and the doors were barred, and the bolts were shot, and Ishtar did not raise her head against the foe. If this fragment be indeed a portion of the Gilgamesh epic, we have no means of asserting whether Gilgamesh was the besieger, or the riser of the siege, or whether he was concerned in the affair after all. Gilgamesh as tyrant. Now we have come to the real commencement of the poem, inscribed on a fragment which some authorities assign to the beginning of the second tablet, but which more probably forms a part of the first. In this portion, we find Gilgamesh filling the double role of a ruler and oppressor of Erech, the latter evidently not inconsistent with the character of a hero. There is no mention here of a siege, nor is there any record of the coming of Gilgamesh, though, as been indicated, he probably came as a conqueror. His intolerable tyranny towards the people of Erech lends color to this view. He presses the young men into his service in the building of a great wall, and carries off the fairest maidens to his court. He hath not left the son to his father, nor the maid to the hero, nor the wife to her husband. Finally, his harshness constrained the people to appeal to the gods, and they prayed to the goddess Aruru to create a mighty hero who would champion their cause. And though fear of whom Gilgamesh should be forced to temper his severity, the gods themselves added their prayers to those of oppressed people, and Aruru at length agreed to create a champion against Gilgamesh. Upon hearing these words, so runs the narrative, Aruru conceived a man in the image of Anu in her mind. Aruru washed her hands. She broke off a piece of clay. She cast it on the ground. Thus she created Ebene, the hero. When the creation of this champion was finished, his appearance was that of a wild man of the mountains. The whole of his body was covered with hair. He was clothed with long hair like a woman. His hair was luxuriant, like that of the corn god. He knew not the land and the inhabitants thereof. He was clothed with garments of the god of the field. With the gazelles he ate herbs. With the beast he slaked his thirst. With the creatures of the water his heart rejoiced. His pictorial representations on cylinder seals and elsewhere, Ebene is depicted as a sort of satyr, with the head, arms, and body of a man, and the horns, ears, and legs of a beast. As we have seen, he is a type of beast man, a sort of Caliban, ranging with the beasts of the field, utterly ignorant of the things of civilization. The Beguiling of Ebene. The poem goes on to introduce a new character, Tisedu, the hunter, apparently designed by the gods to bring about the meeting of Gilgamesh and Ebene. How he first encounters Ebene is not quite clear from the mutilated text. One reading has it that the king of Erech, learning the plan of the gods for his overthrow, sent Tisedu into the mountains in search of Ebene, with instructions to entrap him by whatever means and bring him to Erech. Another reading describes the encounter as purely accidental. However, this may be, Tisedu returned to Erech and related to Gilgamesh the story of his encounter, telling him of the strength and fleetness of the wild man, and his exceeding shyness at the sight of a human being. By this, it is evident that Gilgamesh knows no conjectures, the purpose of which Ebene is designed, and intends to frustrate the divine plans by anticipating the meeting between himself and the wild man. Accordingly, he bids Tisedu return to the mountains, taking with him Ukhut, one of the sacred women of the temple of Ishtar. His plan is that Ukhut, with her wiles, shall persuade Ebene to return with her to Erech. Thus the hunter and the girl set out. They took the straight road, and on the third day reached the usual drinking place of Ebene. Then Tisedu and the woman placed themselves in hiding. For one day, for 2 days, they lurked by the drinking place. With the beast, Ebene slaked his thirst. With the creatures of the water, his heart rejoiced. Then Ebene approached. The scene which follows is described at some length. Ukhut had no difficulty in enthralling Ebene with the snares of her beauty. For 6 days and 7 nights he remembered nothing because of his love for her. When at length he bethought him of his gazelles, his flocks and herds, he found that they would no longer follow him as before. So he sat at the feet of Ukhut while she told him of Erech and its king. "Thou art handsome, O Ebene, thou art like a god. Why dost thou traverse the plain with the beasts? Come, I will take thee to strong-walled Erech, to the bright place, the dwelling of Anu and Ishtar, to the palace of Gilgamesh, the perfect in strength, who, like a mountain bull, wieldeth power over man." Ebene found the prospect delightful. He longed for the friendship of Gilgamesh and declared himself willing to follow the woman to the city of Erech. And so Ukhut, Ebene, and Tisedu set out on their journey. Gilgamesh meets Ebene. The feast of Ishtar was in progress when they reached Erech. Ebene had conceived the idea that he must do battle with Gilgamesh before he could claim that hero as a friend. But being warned, whether in a dream or by Ukhut, is not clear, that Gilgamesh was stronger than he, and withal a favorite of the gods. He wisely refrained from combat. Meanwhile, Gilgamesh also dreamed a dream which, interpreted by his mother, Remat-Belit, foretold coming of Ebene. That part of the poem which deals with the meeting of Gilgamesh and Ebene is unfortunately no longer extant, but from the fragments which take up the broken narrative, we gather that they met and became friends. The portions of the next epic, in order, appear to belong to the second tablet. In these we find Ebene lamenting the loss of his former freedom and showering maledictions on the temple maiden who has lured him thither. However, Shamash, the sun god, intervenes, perhaps in another dream or vision. These play a prominent part in the narrative, and showing him the benefit he has derived from his sojourn in the haunts of civilization, endeavors with various promises and inducements to make him stay in Erech. "Now Gilgamesh, thy friend and brother, shall give thee a great couch to sleep on, shall give the couch carefully prepared, shall give thee a seat at his left hand, and the king of the earth shall kiss thy feet." With this, apparently Ebene is satisfied. He ceases to bewail his position at Erech and accepts his destiny with calmness. In the remaining fragments of the tablet, we find him concerned about another dream or vision. and before this portion of the epic closes, the heroes have planned an expedition against the monster Kumbaba, guardian of the abode of the goddess Ernina, a form of Ishtar, in the Forest of the Cedars. In the very mutilated third tablet, the two heroes go to consult the priestess, Remat-Belit, the mother of Gilgamesh, and through her they ask protection from Shamash in the forthcoming expedition. The old priestess advises her son and his friend how to proceed, and after they have gone, we see her alone in the temple, her hands raised to the sun god, invoking his blessing on Gilgamesh. "Why hast thou troubled the heart of my son Gilgamesh? Thou hast laid hand upon him, and he goeth away, on a far journey to the dwelling of Kumbaba. He entereth a combat whose issue he knoweth not. He followeth a road unknown to him, till he arrive and till he return, till he reach the Forest of Cedars, till he hath slain the terrible Kumbaba and rid the land of the evil that thou hattest, till the day of his return. Let Ea, thy betrothed, thy splendor, recall him to thee." With this dignified and beautiful appeal, the tablet comes to an end. The monster Kumbaba. The fourth tablet is concerned with a description of the monster with whom the heroes are about to do battle. Kumbaba, whom Bel had appointed to guard the cedar, the one particular which appears to be of greater height and sanctity than the others, is a creature of most terrifying aspect, the very presence of whom in the forest makes those who enter it grow weak and impotent. As the heroes draw near, Imbani complains that his hands are feeble and his arms without strength, but Gilgamesh speaks words of encouragement to him. It may be noted, in passing, that the word Kumbaba is of Elamite origin, a fact which has led certain authorities to identify the monster with an Elamite dynasty which anciently dominated Erech, and which came to grief about 2250 BC. It is difficult, if not impossible, to establish the connection between the mythical encounter and a definite historical event, but it may at least be presumed that the bestowal of an Elamite designation on the monster argues a certain enmity between Elam and Babylon. The next fragments bring us into the fifth tablet. The heroes have reached a verdant mountain, paused to survey the Forest of Cedars. When they enter the forest, the death of Kumbaba was foretold to one or other, or both of them, in a dream, and they hasten forward to the combat. Unfortunately, the text of the actual encounter has not been preserved, but we learn from the context that the heroes were successful in slaying Kumbaba. Ishtar's love for Gilgamesh. The sixth tablet, which relates the story of Ishtar's love for Gilgamesh and the slaying of the sacred bull, victory again waits the arms of the heroes. But here, nevertheless, we have the key to the misfortunes which later befall them. On his return to Erech after the destruction of Kumbaba, Gilgamesh was loudly acclaimed. Doffing the soiled and blood-stained garments he had worn during the battle, he robed himself as befitted, a monarch and a conqueror. Ishtar beheld the kings in his regal splendor, the flowers of victory still fresh on his brow, and her heart went out to him in love. In moving and seductive terms, she besought him to her bridegroom, promising that if he would enter her house, in the gloom of the cedar, all manner of good gifts shall be his. His flocks and herds would increase. His horses and oxen will be without rival. The river Euphrates would kiss his feet, and the kings and princes would bring tribute to him. But Gilgamesh, knowing something of the past history of this capricious goddess, rejected her advances with scorn and began to revile her. He taunted her, too, with her treatment of former lovers, of Tammuz, the bridegroom of her youth, to whom she clung weepingly year after year, of Alulu, the eagle, of a lion perfect in might and a horse glorious in battle, of the shepherd of Tabulu, and of Isolanu, the gardener of her father. All these she had mocked and ill-treated in cruel fashion, and Gilgamesh perceived that like treatment would be meted out to him soon should he accept the proffered love of the goddess. The deity was greatly enraged at the repulse and mounted up to heaven. Moreover, Ishtar went before Anu, her father. Before Anu, she went and said, "O my father, Gilgamesh has kept watch on me. Gilgamesh has counted my garlands and my girdles." Underlying the story of Ishtar's love for Gilgamesh, there is evidently a nature myth of some sort, perhaps a springtide myth. Gilgamesh, the sun god or a hero, would have taken over his attributes, is wooed by Ishtar, the goddess of fertility, the great goddess mother who presides over spring vegetation. In the recital of her former love affairs, we find mention of the Tammuz myth, in which Ishtar slew her consort Tammuz, and other mythological fragments. It is possible also that there is an astrological significance in this part of the narrative.